Come on, church, one more time for Paul and the team up here. Praise God. You may be seated. You know, I love all those songs were just amazing, and Paul wrote all those himself, which was just really cool. And if you get to know Paul Baloche, you'll know that for many worship pastors, he's considered the worship pastor's worship pastor. And Paul, I just, while you're up here, just let's, I just want to pick your brain. When you think about like a healthy worship culture in a church, like what's taking place in people's lives and in their hearts in order for that to happen?
Well, it's a good question. It's profound in 30 seconds or less. I just think the Psalms, you know, David just gives us, that's the vocabulary of worship really is in the Psalms. And in a sense, David, thankfully, was so honest and so vulnerable. And of course, the Holy Spirit, through David, wrote most of these songs, the Psalms. And, you know, we read things from David like, why so downcast, O my soul? Come on, put your hope in God. Bless the Lord. Come on, he's the lifter of your countenance, you know? And often David would just talk to him, to his own soul. You know, when my heart is overwhelmed, lead me to the rock. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and don't forget all his benefits. Like he kept talking to his soul. So I think there's a real key for us that when we come into times of corporate worship and then it should just spill into our everyday life is just having that surrendered heart, that heart that keeps turning back to the Lord 1,000 times a day, you know, when we go about our jobs and our school or whatever we're called to do, but just all through the day, just learning to turn our hearts back to the Lord. And I feel like that's what David did. He, even in the worst of times, he didn't withdraw from the Lord. He kept pressing in, saying, come on, you know, come on, soul, press into God. So, you know, and one just practical thing that I do often, even as I'm leading these songs, some of them I've sung maybe 1,000 times, perhaps, As I'm about to sing it, there's a switch in my head or in my heart that says, pray this, Paul. Don't just sing the words on the screen. Like as you sing, like pray this one more time, pray it again, you know, your mercy, God, your mercy, or what we sang this morning. You know, even today's the day you have made, I will rejoice and be glad. Come on, soul, rejoice in the Lord, you know. I won't worry about tomorrow. I'm going to trust in what you say, yes. So instead of it just being a song or words on a screen, that's the key, and I just encourage you to do that too. Just catch yourself in that autopilot. You know, we come into church and it's sort of like, okay, I'm reading words, but it's like just that little, oh yeah, no, pray this song, and it makes all the difference.
That is cool. Isn't that cool, church? So often we can get wrapped up into just singing songs instead of a surrendered heart that's singing prayers. And I got to tell you, that will change the way we worship. So thanks so much for giving us that insight. Really appreciate it.
Thank you. Just I already said earlier, but just another quick shout out to your whole staff, your whole team, from Pastor Jeremy to Ryan to the other Jeremy. Just so many names I could mention, so many volunteers. They fed us. They hosted over almost 600 worship leaders from as far as Kentucky and San Diego and 20 people from L.A. They drove all the way up, a whole worship team of 20 people. So you guys just did such a great job of hosting all these little churches from around the nation, really. And we sent them home yesterday, and most of them are leading worship this morning. So anyway, thank you for your part in that, and just want to give a shout out again, to your leadership, just hosting so well and being gracious to us.
Thank you so much. Paul, one more time. Hey, just real quick, thinking about impact for next year, that's a word for 2017. What we did yesterday and all of the worship leaders that were here, because of your prayer, your generosity, literally thousands and thousands and thousands of people are going to be impacted because of what took place this last weekend. And I'm just so glad we're part of a church. We can have guys like Paul, our staff, that are committed not just to being the best we can be here for our church, but being a church that really is radically impacting churches all over the nation, which is just really, really cool. Hey, go ahead and grab your Bibles and meet me in 1 Samuel chapter 17. 1 Samuel chapter 17. If you don't have a Bible, raise your hand. One of the ushers will get one to you. If you're using a loaner Bible, we're going to be in page 239. 2:39. Today we're looking at the story of David and Goliath as we continue our series, Faith in the Fight. I think for many of us, we've heard the story of David and Goliath. David, the shepherd boy, he throws this rock, hits Goliath in the head, and he kills him. And it's not about just knowing this story. What makes this passage of Scripture extremely powerful is when we apply the same faith that David had to our own lives. When we trust God the way David trusted God, when we see God the way David saw God, it can have a ripple effect in our lives where we're never the same. So let me just set up the context before we dive into 1 Samuel chapter 17. In chapter 15, King Saul is disobeying God. God has rejected him as king, and he decides to get another king in chapter 16. He goes to Samuel and says, Samuel, it's going to be one of Jesse's sons. I'm going to let you know who it is. So Jesse starts looking at his sons. He brings them to Samuel, and Samuel says, I think it's this one. And he starts with the oldest and kind of works his way down, because that's what happened. And he said, no, don't pay attention to the outward appearance, his stature, his height, because God looks not at the outward appearance, but God looks at the what? God looks at the hearts. And he reveals David to be the next king, the youngest son of Jesse's 8 boys. Jesse is watching as David is anointed as king. He will officially take over in 2 Samuel chapter 2. And then we jump into chapter 17, David and Goliath. Goliath is this massive, massive beast of a man. He's over 9 feet tall. Some of you are thinking,
kind of like you, Pastor Jeremy.
No, he's a lot taller than me. Over 3 feet taller than me. Wore armor that was 125 pounds. The spear, just the tip of his spear, was 15 pounds. Josephus, the famous historian from over 2,000 years ago, said that this was a spear that you wouldn't just carry in your hand, but you would carry over your shoulder because it was so massive. And for 40 days straight, morning and night, Goliath, the Philistine, would approach the Israelites and taunt them and say, bring somebody out to fight me. Bring somebody out to challenge me. If one of your Israelites challenges me and beats me, we will be your servants. But if you bring somebody out to fight me and we beat you, you will be our servants. And it's as if day after day, he became more arrogant, more proud. And it says in the Scriptures that the Israelites were frightened. And it's just at this time, Jesse's youngest son, David, goes to visit his 3 brothers. 3 of his brothers were fighting for the Israelites against the Philistines, going up to the lines every day, preparing to watch this battle. Who would Goliath fight? And God's amazing timing allows David to get there at the time when Goliath gives the challenge. Let's stand as we read the Scriptures. We stand as a way of honoring God's word. 1 Samuel chapter 17, picking up in verse 17. And Jesse said to David, his son, take for your brothers an ephah of this parched grain, these 10 loaves, and carry them quickly to the camp of your brothers. Also take these 10 cheeses. Somebody was going to make a serious omelet. To the commander of their 1,000. See if your brothers are well and bring some token from them. Now Saul and they and all of the men of Israel were in the valley of Elah fighting with the Philistines. And David rose early in the morning and left the sheep with a keeper and took the provisions and went as Jesse commanded him. And he came to the encampment as the host was going out to the battle line, shouting the war cry. And Israel and the Philistines drew up for battle, army against army. And David left the things in charge of the keeper of the baggage and ran to the ranks and went and greeted his brothers. As he talked with them, behold, the champion, the Philistine of Gath, Goliath by name, came up out of the ranks of the Philistines and spoke the same words as before. And David heard him. All the men of Israel, when they saw the man, fled from him and were much afraid. And the men of Israel said, have you seen this man who has come up? Surely he has come up to defy Israel. The king will enrich the man who kills him and with great riches and will give his daughter and make the father's house free in Israel. And David said to the men who stood by him, What shall be done for the man who kills this Philistine and takes away the reproach from Israel? For who is this uncircumcised Philistine that he should defy the armies of the living God? And the people answered him in the same way, so shall it be done to the man who kills him. Heavenly Father, God, would you soften our hearts that we may receive your word. Holy Spirit, speak to us today. God, take away any distractions. God, we pray. We pray with humility, asking that you would give us the faith that David had. God, speak to us now. It's in your name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. Today I want us to look at faith that faces giants. Faith that faces giants. A giant is any large challenge that you have in your life. It could be a financial issue, it could be a relational issue, it could be a sin issue, it could be anger, it could be lust, it could be pornography, it could be your heart, having just a hard heart, it could be your mouth, it could be a spirit of unforgiveness, whatever that massive challenge is in your life. And even as I'm saying this right now, most of us have already identified the giant that we have in our life. And as we see from this story today, we're going to either face our giants with faith or with fear. We're going to either see our giants from God's perspective or a human perspective. So what does it look like? What does it mean to have faith that faces giants? Because I wholeheartedly believe that if we can look at our giants the same way David did, with God being the source of his power, God being the source of his strength, God who ultimately was fighting the battle, if we can look at our giants the same way, our lives will never be the same. That God's going to be demonstrated in and through our lives that will impact the lives of others. Faith that faces giants. Four things that I want us to see today. Number one is David's faith saw an opportunity when the people saw an obstacle. David's faith saw an opportunity when the people saw an obstacle. The people were terrified. The army was terrified. King Saul was terrified. They responded with fear. David responded with faith. Because we're going to either see our giants in our lives through our own perspective or through God's perspective. We're either going to see it through the lens of faith or the lens of fear. And for some of us, for most of our life, maybe all of our life, those massive issues in our life, our sin, our obstacles, our challenges, we've been constantly looking at it through the lens of fear. God, it's too big. The giant's too scary. It's too much. It's too massive. It's too huge. I couldn't possibly defend myself. Or today, we can say, God, would you change the way that I see this giant in my life? Instead of seeing it as an obstacle, God, I want to see it as an opportunity to trust you, an opportunity for you to show your power, an opportunity for you to show your faithfulness, an opportunity for other people to see in my life the God that I serve. And what did David do? David called this giant for what it really was. He looked at Goliath, and he wasn't just Goliath. He was an uncircumcised Philistine. Now, some of you are thinking, like, well, is that a derogatory, you know, comment? Is that a derogatory name? No, he was just talking about the Abrahamic covenant. The Israelites were a part of God's chosen people. They had the covenant promises of God, the blessings of God, the favor of God. This was Goliath. He was outside of the covenant. He was a pagan. He didn't have the promises of God. He didn't have the favor of God. He's simply looking at Goliath and calling him for who he truly is. And if we're going to face the giants in our life, we have to do the same thing. Instead of watering down the giants and not really acknowledging their for who they really are, there's a time where we simply call them for what they are. You know, if it's anger in our lives, we quit just saying that we have a short fuse. We own it and say, God, I've got this massive giant in my life that's anger, that's ripping apart my family, it's hurting others. God, I got it. I'm calling it for what it is. The Bible says that it's when it's used wrongly, it's murder. I'm calling the giant for what it is. Or maybe there's adultery going on in your life right now. And you've justified it and you say, you know what, I've got a fling, it's an affair. No, it's an adult, it's adultery. And it's hurting you, it's hurting others. It's calling the giant for what it really is. Maybe you're here today and the reality is you just drink way too much alcohol. You're an alcoholic. And you say, you know what, I've got this disease I'm struggling with. Instead of calling it for what it is and saying, you know what, I drink too much alcohol and I get drunk. The Bible calls that wrong, it's sin, and I'm gonna just call it for what it is. That's what David did. David identified the giant for what it truly was. And he saw it as an opportunity for God to show his faithfulness and not an obstacle to be avoided. For some of you, the giant in your life you've been running from for years. Say, you know what, God, it's too big, it's too massive. And today, that can change. And you say, God, I believe that giant in my marriage, that giant in my relationships, that giant in my finances, that giant in my health, that giant in my heart. God, I believe that it can be an opportunity for you to change me instead of an obstacle to be avoided. See, church, this message can change your life. He goes on, and David asks this question about what's going to be happening to the person that takes down Goliath, and the people say that he's going to get a lot of money. Saul's going to give one of his daughters. You're going to have, like, free housing. And it's almost as if, and I'm not sure the way it went, but it's almost as if day after day, King Saul's like, hey, I'm going to give a bunch of money to whoever wants to take out Goliath. No answer. Okay, I'm going to throw my daughter, right? You can marry my daughter. No answer. Okay, I'm going to give you a free house, you know, your family's going to live for free, and there's still no answer. But David saw this as an opportunity, not an obstacle. Point two in your notes. David's faith did not let criticism stop him. He didn't let criticism stop him. There are so many obstacles already for David to be a part of this. Again, he was a shepherd boy, about 12 miles away from the fighting. He wasn't a part of the army. He wasn't even supposed to be there. He was just showing up. He could have showed up at the wrong timing. Wouldn't have heard Goliath. And there's so many different obstacles. But one of the greatest obstacles David faced is one of the greatest obstacles we're going to face. And that's the obstacle of criticism. Notice what happened in the scripture. It says in verse 28, it says, now Eliab, his oldest brother, heard when he spoke to them, and Eliab's anger was kindled against David. And he said, why have you come down? And whom have you left those few sheep with in the wilderness? I know the presumption and the evil of your hearts, and you have come down to see the battle. And David said, what have I done? Was it not but a word? And he turned away from him toward another and spoke in the same way, and the people answered him again as before. When the words that David spoke were heard, they were repeated before Saul, and he sent for him. And David said to Saul, let no man's heart fail because of him. Let your servant go and fight with this Philistine. And Saul said to David, you're not able to fight against the Philistine and fight with him. You are but a youth, and he has been a man of war from his youth. Three different ways that David was criticized right here. And notice one of the ways is from his brother, somebody that should have encouraged him and supported him. The other was from his boss, the leader of the army, again, somebody that should have encouraged him and supported him. And often the criticism will hurt the most because it comes from people that we think will encourage us and support us. Notice how he was criticized. Number one, his motives were criticized. His motives. His older brother is saying, what are you even doing here? Did you just come to get a front row seat of this war? Shouldn't you be back home? You just want a front row seat of the circus? Like what, David, what's going on in you? Oh, then those sheep. Who's watching those sheep? He doesn't just say sheep. He says few sheep, meaning, you know what? The job that you have is very insignificant. And then he questions his heart. the motivation of his heart, telling him he's basically got a wicked heart. And every time that he's criticized by his brother, not only is it not true, he's thriving in these areas. Why was he even there? Because his dad asked him to go. His dad asked him to go bring food and get a report of his brothers. He was listening to his father's. The sheep, they weren't left alone. He left those in the care of somebody else. Oh, and his heart, he didn't have a wicked heart. Just the chapter before, he was chosen to be the next king because of his heart, a heart that God saw. But his motives were criticized. Notice, second of all, in your notes, that his ability was criticized. His ability, what did Saul say? You are not able. You're not able to do this. Basically, you're not good enough. Has anybody ever told you that? Anybody ever told you you weren't good enough? Maybe, just maybe, you've told yourself you're not good enough. But again, his ability was questioned. And thirdly, his age is criticized. Saul says, you're not able to fight Goliath. You're too small. You're too young. David, you're just not good enough. And I'm reminded of what Paul said to Timothy. Timothy was a young man in training as a pastor. This is what Paul says. He says, let no one despise you for your youth. Some translations put it this way. He says, let no one look down on you because of your young. He says, but set the believers an example in speech, in conduct, in love, in faith, and in purity. David was criticized because of his motives. David was criticized because of his age, because of his ability. And in every single one of these situations, he could have criticized back. He could have criticized his brother. He could have criticized Saul and said, I don't see you guys fighting Goliath. I don't see you guys stepping up to the plate. But spiritual maturity always responds to criticism in a God-honoring way. And most of the time, it's just keeping our mouths shut. There's a giant in your life that's going to be defeated. You're going to have to deal with the criticism. Criticism from family members that will tell you you're not good enough. Criticism from people that you feel like love you, that question your ability. And often I've found in my own life, when I deal with a giant of sin in my life, the greatest criticism comes from me. I tell myself I'm not good enough. I've told myself I'm too young. I've told myself my motives are wrong. And so in the midst of criticism, we need to make sure that we're listening to the right voice, the voice of God, not the voice of others and not the voice of ourselves. But I love this story about David, that even though he was criticized, even though he was told you're not good enough, you're not old enough, your heart's just messed up, he chose to listen to the voice of God and not the voice of others. You want to have faith that faces your giant? Don't let criticism stop you. Point number three in your notes is this. David's faith resulted in confidence and courage. David's faith resulted in confidence and courage. Verse 34, the story says this. But David said to Saul, your servant used to keep sheep for his father. When there a lion came or a bear and took a lamb from the flock, I went after him and struck him and delivered it out of his mouth. And if he arose against me, I caught him by his beard and struck him and killed him. Your servant has struck down both lions and bears, and this uncircumcised Philistine shall be like one of them, for he has defied the armies of the living God. And David said, the Lord who delivered me from the paw of the lion and the paw of the bear will deliver me from the hand of the Philistine. And Saul said to David, go and the Lord be with you. Then Saul clothed David with his armor, and he put a helmet of bronze on his head and clothed him with a coat of mail. And David strapped his sword over his armor, and he tried in vain to go, for he had not tested them. Then David said to Saul, I cannot go with these, for I have not tested them. So David put them off, and he took his staff in his hand and chose five smooth stones from the brook and put them in his shepherd's pouch. His sling was in his hand, and he approached the Philistine. And the Philistine moved forward and came near to David with his shield bearer in front of him. And when the Philistine looked and saw David, he disdained him, for he was but a youth, ruddy and handsome in appearance. And the Philistine said to David, "Am I a dog that you come to me with sticks?" And the Philistine cursed David by his gods. The Philistine said to David, "Come to me, and I will give your flesh to the birds of the air and the beasts of the field." Then David said to the Philistine, "You come to me with a sword and with a spear and with a javelin, but I come to you in the name of the Lord of hosts, the God of the armies of Israel, whom you have defiled. This day the Lord will deliver you into my hand, and I will strike you down and cut off your head." Hello. "And I will give the dead bodies of the host of the Philistines this day to the birds of the air and the wild beasts of the earth, that all the earth may know that there is a God in Israel, and that all the assembly may know that the Lord saves, not with sword and spear, for the battle is the Lord's, and he will give you into our hand." David's faith resulted in confidence and courage. How did he have so much confidence? How was he able to go up to this 9-foot-tall monster and say, "Hey, I'm going to strike you down and I'm going to cut off your head"? David knew God. David knew God's word. David knew the character of God, the power of God, the faithfulness of God. David had this personal relationship with God, which allowed him to trust God. He had so much confidence in who God was. And it wasn't just the knowledge of God's word, but also he had this personal experience with God. There'd been several times in his life where there were lions that attacked and bears attacked. Not a big deal. David manhandled them. David was strong. David was fierce. The Lord came upon David. So David's like, "You know what? I've experienced these monsters in the past. I've taken them out. I can take out this guy." There was this confidence. And when we have that confidence in God, it allows us to be courageous moving to the future. Because it's just another battle. It's just another opportunity for God to show his faithfulness. It's just another opportunity for God to demonstrate and do what only God can do. And when we move forward with confidence, we're going to be not only active, but we're going to be aggressive. And that's what David's doing. And I love this story because it says that he reached down and he grabbed 5 smooth stones. Now, why 5? Some people say, you know, in case he missed. No, David was a sharpshooter. David was an expert. Commentators say that David grabbed 5 stones because Goliath had 4 brothers. See, David wasn't worried about missing. David was completely confident in who he was and the way God wired him and gifted him. Notice his identity in your notes. David was a servant. David was a servant. He was a servant of his father. David was out taking care of the sheep, and his dad said, "Hey, why don't you go check on your brother?" He's like, "Sure, Dad, whatever you want me to do." He was a servant of Saul. It says in verse 32, "Hey, I'm your servant." And that all became apparent, and that was real because of David's identity. He served others because he knew and understood that he was a servant of God. Because when we understand whose we are, we understand who we are. Oh, that was good. I want to say that one more time. When we understand whose we are, meaning that when we understand that we belong to God, we begin to understand who we are. And our whole life is just about being a servant and serving God. And how do we serve God? It's often through the way that we serve others. David, when he was placed with this armor, he simply said, "Saul, this isn't me. It was heavy." I can just picture a young kid with too many snow clothes on, you know, just kind of wobbling around. He says, "This isn't me." And it's almost as if when that was taken off, this weight was removed. David was true to himself. David wasn't trying to be somebody else. Can I just say, for some of you, your whole life is just trying to be somebody else instead of being the person that God has wired you to be. for me, when I was in junior high and high school, I would try to be somebody else. In college, I would try to be somebody else. Even when the transition came as lead pastor several years ago, Pastor David, oh, he's so loved. Such a great Bible teacher. He just looked godly. Sounded like Moses, right? Let my people go, right? He just, whenever he would talk, and I'm just like, man, I just want to be like Pastor David. I'll never forget a friend came up to me and said, Jeremy, just be Jeremy. Can I tell you that was one of the most freeing conversations I've ever had? One of the most freeing things that I've done is just trying to be the person that God has uniquely wired and gifted me to be. One of the most freeing things that you can do is just be the person that God has uniquely wired and gifted you to be. David didn't try to be like Saul. He didn't go out there with the sword. He didn't go out there with all the armor. It's almost as if when he took that off, that weight was removed. For some of you, when you're true to the person that God has wired you and created you to be, there's going to be this almost weight that's removed. You say, God, I just want to be a servant. I want to be the person that you want me to be. I just want to be like Jesus. He says it this way in Ephesians 2:10, for we are his workmanship. Some translations say masterpiece, created in Christ Jesus for good works, for which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. See his identity, but notice second of all, his heart. David was a worshiper. We see throughout the Psalms, David's heart, his surrendered heart for God. That's why God chose him as king. He had a heart for God. Why did David want to defeat the battle? Why did he want to take out Goliath? Was it so that he could experience freedom? Was it so that he could look good in front of others? No, the deeper reason why he wanted to take out the giant in his life was so that God would get the glory. So that people would see, so that people would understand that there is a God in heaven that fights the battles for us. And I love what it says in verse 46. It says, this day the Lord will deliver you into my hand. I will strike you down and cut off your head. That is confidence, because we see this in his heart. We see a man that's just completely confident because of his identity, because of his heart. And we get this picture that we don't often talk about. What does it look like to be a godly man? He was a rugged man. He was a fierce man on the outside, but he had a soft heart. David played the harp. Chapter earlier, when Saul's being tormented by an evil spirit, he requests somebody to play an instrument. They go grab David, the shepherd boy, and he comes and plays the harp for King Saul. This is the same guy that took out a bear, same guy that took out lions. Dude plays a harp. And it wasn't just a harp, it was like a small harp. So picture this, David today, modern day, right? Just keeping it real right now. Modern day, Monday night, guys hanging out, chicken wings, just hanging out, watching the football game, just got done changing the oil on his truck, hanging out with the guys. Halftime happens. What does David do? He goes out to his truck, puts the tailgate down, and plays the harp, right? That's the kind of guy that David was. He was like an M&M candy, the hard shell on the outside, but a soft heart. See, David looked like a man. He was manly, but I believe that if he was worshiping here today, there'd be times that while he was singing with a surrendered heart, he would cry, and he wouldn't be ashamed of that. He would raise his hands, and he wouldn't be ashamed of that, because he was all man, but he had this heart that was just soft for God. What an example of a godly man. Courage and confidence because of Jesus. And then 4.4 in your notes is this. David's faith resulted in God conquering the challenge. David understood that it wasn't going to be him, it was going to be God. Verse 47, it says, let the whole assembly may know that the Lord saves, not with sword or with spear, for the battle is the Lord's, and he will give you into our hand. See, David's strength was that God was the one doing the work. God was the one fighting the battle. maybe that's the issue today. Maybe that's been the issue, is that you've been the one battling your giant. You've been the one facing your giant. Instead of saying, God, moving forward, I want you to face my giant. I want you to slay my giant. I want you to kill my giant. Because this is what happens in verse 48. When the Philistine arose and came and drew near to meet David, David ran quickly toward the battle line to meet the Philistine. You hear what's happening? Goliath, 9 foot plus, starts running towards David. What does David do? He doesn't stand there. He doesn't retreat. Looked a little bit like the river dance. He starts running towards the giant. Why? Because he had confidence and he was courageous. Notice what happens. Verse 49, and David put in his hand in the bag, and he took out a stone and slung it and struck the Philistine on the forehead. The stone sank into his forehead, and he fell on his face into the ground. So David prevailed over the Philistine with a sling and with a stone, and struck the Philistine and killed him. And there was no sword in the hand of David. Then David ran and stood over the Philistine and took his sword and drew it out of its sheath and killed him and cut off his head with it. Then the Philistine, they saw their champion was dead, and they fled. I love this. David has his slingshot with him, his one stone, and he's running full blast probably towards Goliath. And the only exposed part of Goliath most likely was where the eyes were. Probably had a helmet on. He had all of his armor on. Again, it weighed 125 pounds. He had a shield bearer in front of him. And David's like, oh, one little spot, that's all I need. Hits him right in the forehead. The Bible says that it just didn't hit him in the forehead. It sunk into his forehead. David, you know, he's a guy, again, a guy's guy. If he had a CCW, he would be packing a slingshot, right? He just would. Sunk into his head, he falls down. What does he do? He goes up to Goliath, he grabs his sword, and he chopped off his head. Why? Because that's what he said he was going to do. David's faith resulted in God's conquering the challenge. God conquered the challenge through David. So what's that giant in your life? What's that obstacle that now you're going to see as an opportunity? What's that thing that you've been avoiding? That thing that you said, you know what, it's just too much. Where in your life do you need to bring God into the picture and ask God to do what only God can do? Because we have to remember this, two things in your notes. God is greater than our giants. Doesn't matter how big your giant is. Fill in the blank. It could be a sin issue. It could be an addiction. It could be something that you've done in the past. It could be something that you were involved in last night. It does not matter the size of your giant, because our God is always bigger. You know, we serve a God that's a giant killer. God is greater than your giant. Second of all, confidence and courage are contagious. When you have faith to address the giant in your life, you're going to encourage other people to address the giant in their life. When you're able to share with people 6 months from now that you had a giant in your marriage and that you trusted God and you're sharing what God has done, people are going to be encouraged to address the giant in their marriage. That giant in your heart, that giant in your finances, that giant in your relationships, when you start sharing with people what God's done, because you've put your faith in him and you've trusted God, you're going to inspire others. Why? Because when we put our faith in God, courage is always contagious. Confidence is contagious. And that's what we need. Faith in the face of giants. I know what your giant is today, but God knows. And we'll either leave here seeing it as an opportunity or an obstacle. Let's bow. And let's pray. God, I'm amazed and blown away at how relevant your word is. God, stories that took place thousands of years ago that still speak in radical ways to us today. God, we understand and we realize that the giants in our lives we will either face with fear or with faith. They will either be opportunities or obstacles. So God, today we just identify the giants in our lives. God, we don't water them down. We don't try to hide them. God, we surrender them to you and we ask that you would help us. We ask that you would increase our faith. We ask that you wouldn't allow us to be discouraged through criticism or anything else that happens. With all heads bowed, nobody looking around, if you're here today and you've got a giant in your life that you want to face, maybe for the first time, but you're going to ask, you're just saying, I want more faith. I want to see this as an opportunity for God to show his faithfulness instead of just an obstacle. If that's you today, I want to pray for you in a special way. Would you just raise your hand right now, wherever you're at? You've got a giant in your life. You know what it is. I want to pray for you. Just raise your hand wherever you're at. Hands going up all over the room. God, I pray for those that have their hands up right now. God, so many of us have giants in our lives. God, you know what they are. We know what they are. Would you give us faith? Would you give us faith in the fight? Help us, God. God, thank you that like David, we can say the battle belongs to the Lord. It's in Jesus' name we pray.